Funding for New Mexico in Focus provided by viewers like you.
This week on New Mexico in Focus, gearing up in the race for governor. New polling shows Mark Ronchetti tightening the gap as he tries to gain ground on Governor Michelle Lujan Grisham. Plus,
protecting some of these special places requires hard work, commitment, the dedication of resources, but also sacrificing on our own personal part.
Fighting to protect sacred lands. Hear from a tribal leader working to stop hundreds of drilling permits near Chaco Canyon. New Mexico in Focus starts now. Thanks for joining us this week. I'm your host, Gene Grant. A new study shows the U.S. military's economic impact in New Mexico may be larger than we ever realized. At the bottom of the hour, we're going to dive into those numbers and talk about some of the environmental costs that weren't considered in this report. The U.S. military is staying out of a major conflict in Ukraine, at least for now. Coming up later in the show, senior producer Lou DeVizio speaks with a journalist and filmmaker with ties to New Mexico who spent months on the front lines of the war in Ukraine. He tells us why he thinks the Ukrainian people have been so effective in holding off Russian advances. But first, we're staying here in New Mexico where the race for governor has entered a new phase. GOP nominee Mark Ronchetti and Democratic incumbent Michelle Lujan Grisham faced off for their first debate last week on KNME-TV, and there have been new developments since. Let's get right to the line. Welcome to our line opinion panelists. This week, we're happy to have former New Mexico State Senator Diane Snyder. Attorney Laura Sanchez is with us. She's a regular, always glad to have her. And editorial page editor at the Santa Fe New Mexican, that would be Inez Russell Gomez, with us today as well. Thank you, Inez, for joining us. Now, we're starting things off with the governor's race, which has hit another gear after a debate on KOB last week, KOB-TV. We'll get into some of the specifics from that debate in a minute, but we want to get straight some of the new polling data in this contest that informs all of this. It comes from the national polling firm Signal, that's CYGNAL, if you have not heard of that, which collected information from September 27th to the 29th. Now, that poll shows Governor Michelle Lujan Grisham with just a 2-point lead over Republican nominee Mark Ronchetti, 46% to 44%. Now, overall, the website 538 polling, which you might be familiar with, now they have the governor with a 6-point lead over Mr. Ronchetti. And Diane Snyder, let me start with you. Are you surprised to see the race this close? And I should add, Signal identifies itself as a GOP leaning polling firm. So I just want to get that out there too. Are you surprised that he's this close in the race from either poll?
Truthfully, no.
Okay.
I think that, and it, to me, it kind of, I looked at it and I evaluated it based on prior years and prior competitors. Mm-hmm. For one thing, the governor has always been, part of her appeal has been her energy and her enthusiasm and her go-get-it kind of attitude. Mm-hmm. And I felt like that we couldn't see that at this last debate.
Right.
Just a feeling, an attitude, whereas Mr. Ronchetti was very much, Mark is smart, he's well-educated, he's articulate, and he has a people understanding of the issues of what people want to hear, mm-hmm. the thing that impacts them, not what a national poll tells us impacts mm-hmm. the general public. Mm-hmm. So I think he did very well at this last one. And the one thing I came away with is the governor had to keep going back to the issue of abortion. Mm-hmm. It'd be to have something concrete against Mr. Ronchetti. And I think it's an important issue. I think it certainly plays a part in what's happening. But when you're going to the grocery store and you can't buy half the things, you know, that you did buy before, your children can't have new shoes, they're having to wear the old ones. Mm-hmm. It, the economy and the impact, families are feeling that personally more than the abortion issue. Unless you're, I don't know, but I just feel like that makes up the difference. Is Mark talked about crime, and crime is really important. And if you noticed, the governor has now asked the FBI for 50 more agents right. into the state.
That's right.
They said no. So now she's gone to the Justice Department to try to get it. So it clearly reinforces Mr. Ronchetti's contention that we are in dire straits so far as crime. That's kind of where it doesn't surprise me that he's creeping up. Mm-hmm. There's still, quite truthfully, it's a lot of days till election day. Mm-hmm. So that may have been just a bump from the debate, and we'll see what the other one brings.
There you go. Inez, by the way, early voting starts October 11th, which is like right around the corner. Inez, watching that debate on KOB, Mr. Ronchetti, as Senator just mentioned, clearly wanted to go after the governor right out of the gate. He repeatedly called her, quote, out of touch, end quote, with New Mexico citizens. That's an old charge that you see on the national scale. And I'm curious your response to how effective you think that angle of attack is.
Well, I think it's hard to say someone's out of touch when you have a zillion dollar house that you built on television in Angel Fire. I mean, I don't have a second house in Angel Fire mm-hmm. that I had a TV show to furnish and build. And the governor, you know, lived in the North Valley in Albuquerque in just a normal house and runs in the ditches. And now, of course, has the mansion in Santa Fe. She's a mom. She's been a widow. Now she's remarried. She has grandkids. So mm-hmm. I think, you know, I was thinking about what it must have been like to be governor during this pandemic and watch your mother dying and not be able to go see her because that's what you did. And that's, to me, what happened to most of us
yep.
is we couldn't see our family. We dealt with COVID and we went about our lives. I would go back to the debate, though, and I wonder, you know, first of all, the polling average still 4 to 6 points.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, it's going to be close because New Mexico is a closely divided state. I wonder if a debate is as important as what's happening right now on Twitter and on Facebook, where you have the Mark Ronchetti memes, where some genius person decided that Mark Ronchetti would be bad for New Mexico. That's the basic premise.
Mm-hmm.
And they take things like Mark Ronchetti puts ketchup on his tamales. Mark Ronchetti says fried bread instead of fry bread. And then it says bad for feast day, bad for New Mexico. And there are dozens and dozens of these.
Mm-hmm.
And I think back to how many people watch a debate, how many people read the story in the paper. In this one, there was no singular moment where we saw, oh my gosh, she screwed up, or
right.
he was brilliant in that point, or he was terrible in that point. You know, they all did, you know, I think they did their jobs. So I wonder if a debate almost even matters if you don't have a knockout punch.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And meanwhile, underground in a place where young people are and other voters who maybe don't go to the polls as frequently, you know, places like Twitter and Facebook, you have Mark Ronchetti skis and jeans, bad for skiing, bad for New Mexico. I don't know if any of that makes a difference. I have no clue.
Right.
But I think it's really interesting what's happening in the parts of the campaign we don't see on television.
All I know is it's clogging my feed, and I'm like sleeping people for 30 days left and right to get out from under those Ronchetti memes. They're like,
are not very funny. They're not, the nice thing is they're not that mean either. They're just
yeah.
there.
It'd be
but they're not, a lot of them are not good.
Yeah, it'd be better if they were funny. That would be a lot better. Laura, you know, interestingly, I want to go back to something Senator mentioned, and that is the constant use of the abortion issue for the governor. Now, when you think about it, Mr. Ronchetti's been forced to spend TV money up to this day on the abortion issue, and it almost seems like she's got him squeezed in a corner on this, and he can't get other things sort of out there to talk about outside of crime and generalities. Is she on the right track here to just keep hammering abortion? Are these folks onto something here?
So, I mean, I think the abortion issue is so extremely important to mm-hmm. so many people in the state that it would be a misstep for her not to highlight the differences there. I mean,
mm-hmm.
I think that's a huge issue. I think she's been very clear on her position on abortion. She worked to make sure that the law that was still on the books was repealed previously in anticipation of potentially having a situation where the Supreme Court would overturn Roe v. Wade. And so I think that that's a big issue for her, for her base, and for a lot of women in the state.
Mm-hmm.
And people, not just women, but certainly it would be a misstep for her not to keep going back to it. But interesting thing, the observation that the senator had about her continuing to go back to that issue, strikes me, well, I mean, he doesn't have a record. So it's not like she can go back to issues where he's voted or had any, you know, sort of position where he was elected and had a, you know, worked on any policy issues. So it's also kind of tricky because she needs to be able to sort of, in some ways, read the tea leaves about where he might be going on certain issues. And abortion is such a clear one, mm-hmm. where there's a difference there. You know, he's come out with other ads recently about education and talking about how he has a plan for education. That's still, I think, an important issue, the education, economy, you know, the abortion issue. But certainly, I think we're going to see some differences there. And I'm interested to know whether in the next debates we'll have a little bit more fleshing out of those kinds of issues as well. The mm-hmm. more the social, the, you know, the salt, you know, stuff that the average New Mexican would be impacted by. Certainly right. education would be part of that.
No doubt. Senator, just got a quick minute here, but I got to get your opinion on how the governor, current governor, somehow was trying to tie Mr. Ronchetti to former Governor Susana Martinez. I mean, that was so out of the blue. I wasn't even quite ready for that. What did you make of that as a tactic?
Yes, mm-hmm. I was quite surprised because I'm going, in the world I live in, that's not been a major connection.
Right.
I mean, you have seen Susana going out and supporting, I mean, she supports Mark, I assume, but she hasn't been visible.
Right.
So but the problem is all of us who are talking right now is we have more knowledge in some things than the average voter does. So that might work well with the average voter mm-hmm. if they disliked Susana. If they liked her, then so it's a 50-50 chance on whether you're going to gain.
Right.
I don't see her gaining any Republican votes or independent votes by tying him to Susana Martinez.
Gotcha. Inez, can you finish our segment with the same question? You know, an effective tactic, trying to bring in former Governor Susana Martinez into this?
I know, you know, I agree with the senator. Who knows what people will react to?
Yeah.
But I would say this, when you're going to bring her in, say Governor Susana Martinez, not your mentor, because they may not know who your mentor is.
Right.
But I think it's a totally fair comparison because Jay McCleskey is the advisor to both of them. Mm-hmm. He is political, you know, guru guy. And I think if you're a person whose child needs mental health care, or if you needed mental health care, you will have a reaction to the name Susana Martinez. So the key to tying it is to bring back the mistakes that people feel were made in the Martinez administration, mm-hmm. which was the complete destruction of the behavioral health system in New Mexico.
Yep.
So I think if you tie a candidate to a person who did some things that were not good for the state, that can work.
Mm-hmm. Thanks for our line opinion panel on that one. Well, I'll be back here with the group in less than 10 minutes to talk about a new report that details the staggering turnover among New Mexico public school superintendents and the impact it's having on our children's education.
From roads to well pads to the visual landscape to the soundscapes that exist to the migration routes of wildlife to just the ability to connect with a sacred landscape and the ancestors in quietness and peace and solitude. All of that is lost with development.
When you cast your ballot on November 8th, newly drawn district lines will be in use for the first time. Now, we covered that redistricting process extensively, from the independent commission that collected data and input to create recommended boundaries to the legislature's final decision on each redrawn map. Now, a new report is raising questions about the intentions behind those final district lines. This week, New Mexico in Focus correspondent Gwyneth Doland sat down with one of the co-authors of that report to find out how we could make this process more honest and effective.
Professor Gabriel Sanchez, thank you so much for being here.
Always a pleasure. Thanks for having me.
You were part of a team that evaluated New Mexico's redistricting process. It's a big, long, 59-page report.
Yes.
What's the major takeaway for you?
Yeah, long, comprehensive report. You know, if I had to say what's the one take-home message, it's we had a much better process and outcomes with the CRC in place this cycle. But I think both the public and the experts I talked to are ready to go to the next step and have a truly independent commission with actually binding map decisions that doesn't have to rely on the legislature to actually implement them. I think that's the big take-home message. That's what everybody wanted to know. And fortunately, we were able to find a pretty consensus, you know, take on that. And I think that hopefully is helpful as we think about the next cycle some years from now.
Yeah, I mean, in terms of some of the problems that we have seen in the past, I've done a lot of reporting on redistricting. You've looked at this a lot. The number one thing that people said to me, people who had been a part of it, lawmakers, demographers, said that the legislature pursues an incumbent protection plan. They draw districts that they are going to win next time. You know, New Mexico state lawmakers tend to protect themselves. And you found, but that was anecdotal. You found some evidence for it.
Yeah, obviously that was one of the big research questions that we started the report with. You know, the line you often hear is, you know, we should make sure that we have constituents that pick their legislators, not the other way around, legislators getting to pick who their constituents are through the redistricting process. And, you know, a couple of different ways to look at that. One, in the survey, we asked folks about their perception of how that was done. Unfortunately, the legislature, and particularly the Senate, wasn't rated very well by the public, and we surveyed highly likely New Mexico voters. So these are the folks paying close attention to what was going on the ground. And probably more importantly, we actually had map analysis. Dr. David Cottrell, who actually did all the map analysis for the CRC itself, lent his expertise to our cause and did that for our evaluation report. And although there's some positives we can talk about in his map analysis, when it came to looking at incumbency advantage, he found that there was unfortunately evidence that there were more protection of incumbents through the legislature's maps, and much more so than the CRC, and a bunch of computer-generated algorithm-based maps that are supposed to take politics out of the equation. So at the end of the day, you'd have to conclude that there was protection of incumbents this redistricting cycle, and that, I think, confirms what we often hear on the ground anecdotally from folks, which is important for us as researchers. Whenever you test a question, you don't know what the answer is going to be, but when it's in line with what the experts are telling you they're seeing on the ground, you know you've really got something there.
And here's something I found surprising. You know, one thing that a lot of people had predicted was you've got, you know, Democrats in control of the legislature and the governor's office. A lot of people said they are just going to run the show here. They're going to make this a complete political gerrymander and advantage themselves the whole way. In terms of the congressional districts, which you guys didn't look at, people are saying that looks like a Democratic gerrymander. But did you find that for the legislature?
No, really important question and an important finding. We actually didn't find strong evidence that there was any partisan gerrymandering, at least in the state maps. Our focus was at the state level. And I think you've got to give Democrats a lot of credit, because as you alluded to, right, they had the opportunity to really push through some maps that would highly advantage their party, and that didn't happen. And in fact, even Republicans we spoke with that were on the CRC or just that follow the process closely, they all basically had to give credit to Democrats and said, you know, they really could have made this much worse for us. And they really did put forth, at least in terms of thinking about partisan gerrymandering, a pretty fair set of maps. You got to give them credit for that.
But I mean, if you're protecting who's in office now and they have strong majorities in both houses, all you have to do is protect the incumbents and you've got... You continue Democrat dominance despite the changes.
Well, as you know well, when it comes to partisan politics, there's no limits on how big of an advantage you can have.
That's right.
So I was predicting, actually, and a lot of folks I know in the legislature, as we started conversations about the CRC, a lot of them would tell me, you know, Gabe, I'm with you principally on this, but we're going to have an opportunity to really take it to Republicans. And so I perceived going into this, we were going to see a lot more extremity in that. And reality is, there really wasn't a big problem there in terms of partisan gerrymandering, which I think is a win for everybody in the context of this cycle.
That's so interesting. You know, this is the first time that an advisory commission was part of the process. That's new. Overall, how did the commission do?
Well, I think at least on a couple of really important pieces of the puzzle, they did an outstanding job. And I'd like to start by just noting everybody we talked to and the evidence that we collected suggested this was probably the most successful redistricting cycle, at least in recent memory in the state of New Mexico. And everybody attributed that to the presence of the CRC. And one area where I think it really stood out was in terms of community engagement. A lot of this, you've got to give huge amount of respect to Justice Chavez, who led the CRC. He made some really important decisions that opened up access points to a wider segment of the community, especially tribal members of the community that don't often have the opportunity to engage in this process. And consequently, we saw it a number of different ways in our analysis, much more engagement from the public than you typically see during redistricting processes. And I think that was definitely a result of the CRC's presence that really worked hard to ensure that they met the community at least halfway and made it easier for them to engage.
Yeah, people said to me so many times that the community engagement before was a dog and pony show, and it wasn't like that this time at all. But you do have some recommendations for improvements. So even if, you know, no matter what shape the commission takes next time, what needs to improve or what should be different?
Yeah, even though a lot of wins, I say technology was a big win that should be continued, gave people an opportunity if they couldn't get there in person, participate virtually. Biggest thing probably I heard the most about was being able to actually play around with map analysis and software as an average member of the public. I think that was incredibly valuable, but of course there's always recommendations of things that didn't go well. If we're talking specifically about the CRC, you've got to start with who is actually on the committee and how that naming process and vetting process worked. Huge conversation early on, right? Big missteps, unfortunately, for the CRC. You had very low levels of gender representation. It was almost exclusively male. You had no Native Americans, almost exclusively from Albuquerque and other metro areas. So we need to do a better job of diversifying the committee moving forward, whatever it is, if it's the CRC 2.0 or if it's a truly independent commission. Let's do a better job of making sure it's more representative of average New Mexicans, not just those that are political elites or connected to the system. Let's do a better job with that, I think, is the number one thing that I heard. And you also had a whole lot of really strong concerns about the role of the legislature in this segment of the process. Even though I will say, again, a lot of credit to be paid to the legislature in doing a good job on partisan gerrymandering and other things, you actually heard a number of legislators directly state, hey, CRC, you did a really good job, but you know what? It's our time in the process and we've got this. And in essence, I think it led to a lot of folks in the community perceiving the CRC didn't really have the power and authority to do as much as we would like to have seen, because at the end of the day, in many cases, it looked like the legislature just threw things out and did their own things, unfortunately, sometimes behind closed doors without transparency. And that, we heard loud and clear from voters in the survey, is not what they want to see moving forward. In fact, of all the different things we put in front of them, what they prioritized is transparency. Everything should be out in the light of day is what the public wants to see.
Professor Sanchez, thank you so much for talking to us.
Absolute pleasure. I appreciate the opportunity to talk about something other than election analysis this time of year. Thank you.
Online right now, we have another quick conversation between Gwyneth and Dr. Sanchez about how the redrawn congressional maps could impact the November election. Just go to our New Mexico in Focus YouTube page to see that. Now, bringing back our line opinion panelists, a recent report from the Santa Fe New Mexican is exposing what education officials call a serious problem at districts around the state, and that is high turnover rates among superintendents. New Mexico's Public Education Secretary Kurt Steinhaus says the state had 37 new supes at the start of the 2021-22 school year, and that's out of 89 districts statewide, by the way. The article has gotten a lot of reaction since it was published, as you might imagine. Inez, we are all surprised to see that statistic because, I mean, turnover at that position is a big problem we're about to talk about. I'm interested in your reaction to that number, though.
I'm not surprised because I was an education reporter for a long, long time before I became an opinion writer. And school boards are notoriously political.
Yep.
And when boards change, superintendents change. And I think in recent years, the many mandates, the public criticism, just the pressure of being a school superintendent is causing people to get other jobs. Mm-hmm. And then you have the instances where a few years ago we had a bright young thing, Joel Boyd, who was our superintendent, and he was there for a couple of years to make a mark and to leave.
Right.
And so you have that phenomenon as well. Mm-hmm. And I think education, for all that we all want it to be improved and have education outcomes better for kids, that if we did nothing for 5 years except fund it and leave teachers and superintendents alone to do their jobs, we would be surprised at how good our results would be.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we have an elementary school in Santa Fe called Pinon Elementary, which was one of the largest. It reflects the population of the town in that it had a bunch of minority kids, a bunch of poor kids, a bunch of middle-class kids. It was almost Santa Fe in a microcosm. Mm-hmm. And it should not have tested well, but it did. Mm-hmm. And the reason was that Janice Devote was the principal for I don't know how many decades. and she's retired and she trained somebody, and we have another good principal apparently who's leading Pinon again. And when you have that kind of longevity and excellence in leadership, you do fine. And that's what we need to do with our superintendents in our districts. Mm-hmm. You know, Eladio Chavez is our superintendent now in Santa Fe. He's very young. He's in his second year. Hopefully he will, you know, dig down and give us, you know, 5 or 10 years and do a great job.
Yep. Have to tip our hat to Robert Knott, however, from your newspaper for a great job on this story. He really knocked this thing out. I highly recommend it at the Santa Fe, New Mexican, if for you folks watching. Laura, interesting. COVID-19 was mentioned, of course, as a deterrent for many professions. Are we past the problem, perhaps, for superintendent turnover now that the pandemic has passed? Is this an anomaly, or how do you see this?
I think that superintendent turnover is always an issue. I think in a good year, or I guess, you know, a non-COVID year, it's going to be an issue. There's just a lot of moving, you know, a lot of movement across different districts. There can be some differences in terms of pay, you know, opportunities. I think you see a lot of movement, but COVID has certainly exacerbated all of that for mm-hmm. superintendents. It's made it very, very stressful for them to have a cohesive, you know, campus, a school district that actually functions well. You've got a lot of issues with absenteeism. There's a lot of pressure regarding, you know, making sure that students have what they need and that teachers are also able to do their job. I mean, I think there's so much uncertainty, and I think it's caused a lot more stress for superintendents. And we just, in general, it's hard for us to attract people from out of state for these positions. Mm-hmm. And then we just have like not that many people in state that have risen to that level of becoming superintendents. So I think it's a real problem, and one that I hope that the Secretary Steinhaus is looking at. It sounds like they're certainly trying to figure out how to add more resources to the issue, training, whatever's necessary to make sure you continue to grow people and keep them in positions. Because mm-hmm. that turnover, you know, creates such a huge problem, whereas districts that have had a longtime superintendent, you see them able to do better over time.
That's right.
Because they have those relationships that they've developed. For example, Sue Cleveland in Rio Rancho,
yep.
You know, makes a big difference.
Senator, the most interesting part of the story to me, managing relationships with school boards. I mean, this is a fraught situation for every superintendent. It's become so politicized, though. School boards. Do you know what I mean? You got people openly running, ostensibly in opposition to the current superintendent. I mean, what are superintendents supposed to do with recalcitrant, difficult boards? Is this part of the problem here?
I think they do a lot of praying to, I'm sorry. I don't mean to be flippant about this, because this is a very, very serious issue. Mm-hmm. I think one of the things that, and school boards have this ability with the help of the legislature, is one of the points that really struck me was the fact that in many cases, the pay between a top level teacher and a superintendent is minimal.
Right.
And you're going, okay, I can stay here and I can make this much. I can make 5,000 more if I go over here, but I've got 15 new responsibilities that are, and it becomes, is it worth it for me to do that?
That's right.
And yes, I have been amazed at how, because I grew up in a small town in Texas, and my daddy actually was on the school board at one time. But politicizing of it is, I see it becoming like county commissions are.
Right.
And it really worries me to do that. And instead of focusing on children, they're focusing on who's in charge and who's going to decide what we're teaching.
Mm-hmm.
And I think teachers who have the knowledge and experience to become superintendents go, no, thank you.
Well, we've got another problem here, and that's principal turnover as well.
Yeah.
And that's part of it as well. Inez, let me give you the last word on this, on the school board issue. Once again, the school board part of their job is to be able to fire the superintendent, right? It's your boss. And how to manage that political, you know, minefield, to me, that would be the number one reason I would get out of the job, especially in a hot job market where, as Laura said, you can make 5 to 10 grand more. What's your thought on that?
No, the school board is to pass the budget and hire and fire the superintendent. Those are their legislative charges. Mm-hmm. It's not to hire the wrestling coach or to fight with somebody over whether the teacher is doing curriculum that you don't like. Mm-hmm. What I would say is that it's really important. We're lucky in New Mexico that some of the political battles that have happened in other states that we've seen with screaming and all that kind of thing, mm-hmm. we don't have that yet to that degree. We do have, sadly, school boards that are there to make sure their cousins get jobs and get rid of the superintendent because he wasn't mean to the coach who was mean to their grandson, that kind of thing. And we just need to get over that. The job of schools has to be educating children. You know, Eddie Ortiz was the superintendent of Santa Fe Public Schools for over a decade before he sadly died in surgery too early. And he told me a great story about his first interview for a teaching job. He had gone to West Las Vegas and he got interviewed by the school board. And when he was interviewed by the school board for a teaching job, he said, I think I'll stay in Santa Fe. And he went back to Santa Fe, rose through the ranks, and was an absolutely visionary superintendent.
There you go.
And we need more people like that.
That's a good story there to wrap that up. Exactly. Thank you all for that conversation. All right. We'll be right back here at the virtual roundtable in just about 10 minutes to talk about a new study detailing the military's impacts here in New Mexico. But it's what was left out of that report that's concerning environmentalists. Another environmental issue is circling overhead for people living near Chaco Canyon. They're challenging a plan for 370 new drilling permits near the national park. All right, now for decades, those developments have encroached on and destroyed landscapes that are sacred to many of the Southwest tribes. In the coming weeks, you'll hear from some of the people trying to protect Chaco. And this week, our land senior producer, Laura Paskus, talks with Teresa Pasquale with the Pueblo of Acoma.
Hi, Teresa. Thanks for being here.
Hi, Laura. How you doing? Thanks for having me.
I'm good. So I wanted to start, and I wish we were actually sitting there together today right now. Chaco Canyon. Lots of people are familiar with it as a national park and a place they might visit for a day or maybe camp. But it's a lot more than that to the people of the Pueblo of Acoma and other tribes. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about why Chaco Canyon is so special.
Sure. Chaco Canyon, as most people refer to it and know it as, is referred to as Washbashaka. There at my home community of Acoma. And it's significant because it plays an important role in the movement and migration of our people as they made their way into present-day Acoma. Many pueblos and many tribes have some kind of relational context to that special and sacred place. Many pueblos reaffirm their present-day connection to Chaco and also have stories and oral histories that take them through that greater Chacoan landscape as they made their way to the present-day pueblos that they occupy now. And so these places were places where our ancestral people and their clans really started to form and organize into the distinct societies and Pueblo communities that we have today. And so they brought that knowledge, that skills, those the teachings that they acquired over centuries of living on the landscape, and really brought that forward into the present day communities. And so what we have now in our Pueblo communities here in the state of New Mexico really are the descendants of those people, the ancestral people who once occupied those lands. And so that's what gives it special meaning.
So in the last, many decades, probably since the 1940s, the San Juan Basin has been a place that has been drilled for natural gas and more recently for shale oil, I think it's called. And I'm curious, you know, there are hundreds, thousands of wells around that Chacoan landscape. And I know there's broad impacts, but what are some of the ways in which that drilling has affected the landscape and the people who are a part of it?
We know that over 90% of federal lands in that greater Chacoan landscape have already been permitted for exploration and development. what the Pueblos and tribes have long been asking for their federal agencies is really the protection of that last remaining, I would say, even less than 10% as development continues. What is lost in that landscape really is everything that the development touches that is needed to support that kind of extraction, from roads to well pads to the visual landscape to the soundscapes that exist, to the migration routes of wildlife, to just the ability to connect with a sacred landscape and the ancestors in quietness and peace and solitude. All of that is lost with development, and you don't have to go far to see it. Whether you come in from the north side or come in through the south entrance to the park, one will see what different types of extraction have done over decades of development in that area. Because my village, Acoma, sits to the south, I happen to come in from the south entrance to the park. And it is never lost on me that just in that short trip to Chaco, that one can see uranium development. We can see the impacts of coal and coal mining in that area, and now oil and gas. And because, as I've said, our history isn't written in our Pueblo communities and many tribal communities, that history, that connection to place is all held in the transmission of our languages through those stories, prayers, and songs. That as that land is disturbed and developed, it becomes as if one is erasing the pages of that history book. And we can't grow a new landscape. Certainly one may say, well, after the development, we'll try and regrow the grass and the plants. But really, the context is lost. And so when we lose that and the ability to bring our children to those places to teach them, then what we're impacting is the ability of a present day community to not only transmit that knowledge, but all of the knowledge that's contained within that landscape. Our ability to understand concepts in terms of conservation, in terms of stewardship, in terms of understanding how to deal with climate change. All of those answers are contained within that landscape, but it can only be possible if those communities are still allowed to make that very present day connection and actively use that landscape as it was intended.
So the Trump administration had approved almost 400 new drilling permits, which a coalition of tribes and environmentalists and archaeologists have really been opposing and pushing back on this development for years and years, and are now trying to reverse that decision, but the Biden administration is sticking to it. Why do you think we as a society seem unable to or unwilling to protect these most special and limited of places?
I think it's hard for all of us because we're not willing to make that sacrifice. Protecting some of these special places requires hard work, commitment, the dedication of resources, but also sacrifice on our own personal part. We all live in an environment that is heavily dependent on oil and gas, and we haven't really invested long enough with enough resources to start really moving us away. We have just really begun that transition. here in the state. But what we need is really to understand what is that impact on present day communities. And what is lost if we fail to act, if we fail to move, if we fail to make that commitment towards change?
Well, thank you, Teresa. I appreciate you talking with me.
Thank you for having me.
You can catch that full conversation between Teresa and Laura. Just search for the Our Land channel on YouTube. Let's bring our line opinion panel back for one more discussion this week. The University of New Mexico's Bureau of Business and Economic Research looked at data from 2019 from Cannon Air Force Base, including Melrose Air Force Range, Holloman Air Force Base, Kirtland Air Force Base, and White Sands Missile Range. Now, those four installations are estimated to generate nearly $3 billion in labor income and a combined industrial output of more than $14 billion. Laura, do you have any idea the economic impact was that huge in the state? I mean, we know it's huge, but that's huge.
Yeah, I mean, I think some of the comparisons between that impact and other manufacturing or even like oil and gas sector and others, I think that was what was very interesting when you see the magnitude. Mm-hmm. I mean, I know that obviously I think, you know, it's clear that we have a lot of military installations here. We have a strong federal presence. Between military installations and the labs. And so I know that it generates some economic development and jobs, but certainly I wasn't aware of the full magnitude of it until this report. And I think that that means that it's, you know, it's pretty important that we have solid relationships, I think, with our, that our congressional delegation have good relationships with the administration in Washington and with the Department of Defense and others to make sure that we're not on the chopping block, so to speak, for any kind of closures, because I think that will have a huge impact.
BRAC is not a good word around here. Those four letters, BRAC. Inez, the study also looked into the state's more than, and this is another stat that's interesting, more than 140,000 veterans who make up nearly 9% of our adult population. That's amazing. And veterans in our state, even more interestingly, earn on average 64% higher wages than non-veterans. Something to be proud of, or is that a gap we should, I don't know, be concerned about?
I think that one of the reasons people join the military is so they can get, you know, their education paid for.
Yep.
And one of the things you learn in the service, you know, whatever your opinion is of having too big of a standing military or not, is you learn how to work, you learn how to take orders, and you learn how to complete tasks. So if you come back to work and you know those things, you're going to do well. You know, my favorite cousin who did not finish college because he got busy working, is the most successful of all of our 18 first cousins and has stayed on at a local big company through like 50 layoffs because he learned how to work, how to ask questions, and how to get the job done. So what I would think is if I was a non-veteran, which I am, but I would learn to work as well as the people who were in the military. I think a great work ethic will take you far.
Mm-hmm. Senator, we've covered the positives, and there's a lot of them for the military presence here, but what about the costs? And what I mean by that, PFAS contamination from Cannon and Holloman, you know, jet fuel spills at Kirtland and the Superfund site at White Sands, these all created costs to public health, the environment, future generations burdened with cleanup costs and health impacts. Should these have been factors for consideration as well?
Well, I think they are now, which is something that I think is important by making the public aware and elected officials of all these things, because if you're not, if you don't get involved and you don't get told that that's going on and being reported on, then you don't have concerns. You just see the $14 billion. I think that as we go forward, and we've seen some monies appropriated to help do some of the cleanups and stuff, I think there will be a greater pressure on our elected officials, particularly our congressional delegation. I mean, we don't, with all due respect to the five of them, we don't have Pete Domenici up there fighting our battles to keep us going. And yes, we need to look at the environmental issues and the health issues, but what do we replace $14 billion with?
Right.
And I think that's, I think people are concerned about that.
Mm-hmm. Good point there. Hey, Laura, real quick, another significant cost, gonna stick with environment here, is pointed to is climate change. The Department of Defense is the world's largest institutional user of petroleum. A lot of folks don't know that. And the single largest institutional producer of greenhouse gases as a consequence. Now, as a state that carries a larger burden than most when it comes to climate change, should we be more critical how we perceive military's contributions on that?
Well, I think certainly just having the information about what the impacts are is important. I think that, mm-hmm. you know, the report that we looked at was an economic report. They were looking at the potential economic benefit of military installations, but mm-hmm. a more comprehensive look at the environmental impacts would certainly be a useful corollary to that. But I think that, you know, in terms of the direction that the military is going, that's something that the federal government has to look at and consider in its planning across the whole country. I mean, mm-hmm. I think we have impacts here, but I don't think they're necessarily disproportionate to what's happening in other states. So it's something that I think at the federal level, and certainly our delegation can bring those issues up. But I know that over, I'd say the last 15 years since I've been aware of sort of renewable development, certainly the military has started to look more at trying to be more sustainable in their practices and trying to incorporate more renewable energy. But I think that, I mean, they're gonna continue to move forward. And just given the geopolitical issues that we have, we need to have a strong military. And so it makes sense to think more sustainable long-term mm-hmm. to address some of the climate change issues.
Interesting point there. I know it's interesting, there's a story this week. The Navy is now working very hard on battery power, EV for submarines. And they're gonna get there, you know what I mean? And the military can lead on these things. They have an interesting position. Do you know where I'm driving at here? To really affect change in a lot of ways.
Well, when you think about the military, they helped desegregate the country earlier than everybody else. And
that's
I
right.
think the Defense Department has identified climate change as one of the threats to the country and the world. Mm-hmm. So I do believe that they will act. We have to get from petroleum to other ways to power vehicles. Mm-hmm. And if they can do it fast, I bet you they will.
Yep.
Because they're always looking at what works and what's efficient.
Thanks again to our line opinion panel as always this week. Our Land senior producer Laura Paskus wrote extensively about this in her weekly newsletter. You can find a link and sign up for that on nmpbs.org. Now, our government and military leaders are watching closely as Russia continues its invasion of Ukraine. Russian President Vladimir Putin Wednesday signed laws annexing parts of the country into Russian control in the latest escalation in that conflict. Now, we spoke to Ukrainian citizens here in New Mexico when the war began in February. And since, we've been in contact with a journalist and filmmaker who's been on the front lines. Patrick Hilsman has covered military conflicts for years and has family right here in New Mexico. Senior producer Lou DeVizio was lucky enough to sit down with him on a recent stop in Albuquerque to talk about the horrors and the triumphs he's witnessed during his time covering the war.
Joining me today in studio is Patrick Hilsman. He's an independent filmmaker and journalist who spent the last several months in Ukraine. Thanks for speaking with us today, Patrick. First, why Ukraine? I know you've worked in areas of conflict before as a frontline journalist. What about this situation pushed you to go and document what was happening there?
I felt something of an obligation because I had been covering a lot of wars that Russia specifically has been involved in, and I've written a lot of open source investigative pieces about Russian weaponry. And the fact that there was a large war that was involving some of the topics that I'd previously covered. And also one of my best friends is a Lebanese Ukrainian who I met about a decade ago back when I was covering Syria. And as the invasion kicked off, he was just chronicling the story of his village, which was being surrounded by Russian forces. Thankfully, they never made it in, but they were approximately 2 kilometers from his house. And the Russian and Ukrainian soldiers were actually firing at each other over his home. And he suggested that I come visit him and do some journalism. And I stayed in Lviv, which is to the west, and also traveled across the country to Zaporozhye, Kharkiv, Kramatorsk, which is in Donbass, Ternopil.
You know, how did Ukraine compare to being the other wartime scenarios that you've been in, that you mentioned Syria?
The major difference was that in Syria, one side had absolute overwhelming firepower, and the other side we essentially had almost no firepower. The fact that the Ukrainians have stuff like early warning systems, advanced satellite technology that the Americans have provided them, has made a huge difference. Just having a warning of a few minutes is the difference between soldiers getting blown up in an airstrike and being able to take shelter and surviving. I witnessed things like that, where the technological edge that the Ukrainian forces have in some circumstances saves lives. And that's a massive difference. Whereas in Syria, the regime forces would simply encircle cities and just blow them to smithereens. They've flattened cities as well in Ukraine, but the difference is that it's come at a terrible cost for them to do that. Whereas in Syria, they were able to do it with relatively few casualties and thus no consequences.
Your piece, Comedy at War, that you shared with us, featuring Valaria, what made you want to follow a comedian, of all people, in a wartime scenario?
In a war, the kind of gallows humor that people have really says a lot about the conditions that they're in and what they need to get through the day. And what I felt was compelling about her was that she was an internally displaced person from the city of Kharkiv, which is a majority Russian-speaking city in eastern Ukraine, which has been viciously targeted by the Russian forces, okay. Which is in itself quite ironic because a large number of the victims of Putin's aggression have been the Russian speakers of Ukraine. And this runs counter to the propaganda that they've put out saying that they're liberating the Russian speaking population. Of course, the president is Russian speaking. The experience that she described to us is absolutely harrowing because part of what makes it so stressful for people to leave home is that as they left, they didn't even know where they'd end up because the trains had to take the safest route to the west. So sometimes that would mean that they would end up in Ternopil, or they'd end up in Lviv, or elsewhere. And to have a country which in many ways looks like my country, they don't have Starbucks, but you can go into a coffee house, which is the equivalent of Starbucks. They have contactless payment. Everything appears as it would in America in a lot of ways. But then a few kilometers away, there's the second largest army in the world invading. And it was interesting to learn how people are really stubbornly insisting on clinging to daily life. And in Kharkiv, for example, there is constant shelling. There have been a horrible number of civilian casualties, yet the subway still runs. And having the subway operational, despite shelling, despite bombing, despite Russian forces literally trying to encircle the city at a certain point, is very, it's inspiring. And it shows a certain amount of stubbornness to insist on continuing daily life. And I think that she, going on stage, making jokes about the war, which has robbed her of her home and of her career for the time being, was definitely something that we could all learn from.
Sure. You mentioned that stubbornness, and we've heard examples of that from other people that we've talked to from Ukraine who are here in New Mexico and just watching news stories. But how much do you think that plays into the relative success that Ukraine has had holding off the Russians?
I think that people might put a little bit too much emphasis on there being some kind of unique character trait to people that live there.
Okay.
Because they're not terribly different from anyone else in how they view life. People want their kids to go to school. People want to be able to enjoy their life and laugh and be happy, and people are still getting married. But it's part of the reason that they've been so successful in fighting back is simply that they just don't want to die. They've seen what's happened in cities like Mariupol, and it's an apocalypse. So the idea of banding together to try to resist that is not, it doesn't necessarily take a unique outlook or a unique stubbornness to be willing to resist. It's just people's insistence on living is really what their secret weapon is, I think.
Now, you're back here in New Mexico where your parents live, and coming back, what do you want people to know here in the US, but here in New Mexico also, about what's happening in Ukraine?
I want people to know that the propaganda that's being put forward about it being some kind of country that's oppressive to Russian speakers is laughable. President is a Russian speaker. The cities that are suffering the most from Russian bombardment are majority Russian speaking. A lot of the times if you go out on the front lines, the soldiers will be speaking in Russian. And it's in some parts of the country, it's unusual to hear Ukrainian spoken. And that is the pillar of Putin's propaganda, is the notion that he's liberating the Russian-speaking population of Ukraine. And it's just false, because the Russian-speaking cities have been just viciously targeted. And I think that it's important for people to understand that that is not true. That is not a truthful message that's coming from Russia. Secondly, Ukraine needs aid, period. There is a huge lack of some basic supplies. Fuel is almost impossible to come by. It's rationed. And for people to be able to live normally, they need vehicles, because Ukraine is a gigantic country. So traveling between cities now that air travel is grounded is incredibly difficult. You can be in a car for 24 hours sometimes, and you just have to get used to living in cars in order to travel anywhere. And things like solar energy, hybrid vehicles, cars with better gas mileage, basic medical equipment, things that people are not thinking of very much in the media or in public consciousness are needed out there. For example, there's a lot of volunteers that are going over there to fight, right? Ukraine has a large army, and it has a lot of manpower. What would probably be more helpful for them would be experienced drivers or medics or people that are good at operating drones, people that are good at repairing vehicles, people that are good at software. There's a need for everything now. And we just look at the military side, but Ukraine's success so far has as much to do with them insisting on keeping civil society active as it does on the military aspect. Actually, one of the first things I said when I got there was that I think Ukraine might actually be successful in this war. And my friend said, why? And I said, because I just paid for a soda at a gas station with a credit card, and it still works. A lot of the areas around Kyiv that were devastated by the Russian bombardment, you can go there now and they're repairing them. I was headed east once, and I remember we had to, there was a destroyed bridge, and we had to sort of drive down by the riverbed to a little, to a smaller bridge that had been built to try and to compensate for the fact that the bridge was blown up. And then a couple weeks later, when we came back, there was a new bridge there. And I said, this was blown up last time we were here, right? And it was repaired. So you see people fixing things under bombardment. That's extraordinary. And if you want to talk about what is contributing to them being able to at least fight for their independence, I think it has a lot to do with that. It's not just soldiers, it's everybody.
You can watch a longer version of that interview Saturday evening on Colores. That airs at 4 p.m. right here on NMPBS. You can also watch Patrick Hilsman's short film Comedy at War on the New Mexico in Focus YouTube page. Thanks again for joining us and for staying informed and engaged. We'll see you again next week in Focus.
Funding for New Mexico in Focus provided by viewers like you.